Thank you. So, my name is Douglas Wolk, and I'm going to explain Immanuel Kant's 1790 philosophical masterwork, The Critique of Aesthetic Judgement, the incredible book in which he explains what beauty is, what art is, and why people like stuff. And the reason this has to be the drastically condensed, awesome version is that if you try to read Kant's actual text, it will make your brain explode. He was a great thinker and one of the very worst writers of all time. In fact, his translator actually referred to his repulsive style. Nonetheless, he manages to break down the basic experiences that, through which we assess things into four kind of different categories of what he calls reflective judgments. You can say that an aesthetic experience is agreeable, or good, or beautiful, or sublime, which is this kind of weird fourth category that gets batted around a lot. But what's unusual about judgments of beauty is that they are disinterested. That means that you don't have a horse in the race. You don't care about what's being represented. You don't care about the thing itself. You can't say, you know, your house may appear beautiful to you, but that's, you have interest because it's your house, you live there. So you can't really say, if you see this picture of Wolverine, you say, this picture of Wolverine is beautiful because he's badass. And the answer is no. This picture of Wolverine is agreeable because he's badass. It's something that you personally like, but that's not a judgment of beauty. If you see this next picture of Wolverine here and you say, like, oh, this picture of Wolverine is beautiful because he's good, he's a superhero, he's fighting for what's right when all seems lost. No, that's not a judgment of beauty either. That's a judgment of moral goodness, which is something that Kant says that you can prove independently. It doesn't have anything to do with the fact that it's Wolverine or that he's good or any of that stuff that's being represented. However, if you see this picture of Wolverine's awesome adamantium claws and say, wow, I have no idea what this is, but I really like the composition and the color and the straight lines of that, Kant would say, yes, that's a judgment of beauty because you're judging it independent of any interest in it, independent of what content it is. Another thing that he says about beauty is that it has the form of finality. So if you see something in nature or art that's beautiful, it seems to have been designed with a purpose, even though it hasn't been. There's a lot of weird little contradictions like that about beauty in Kant's estimation of what beauty is. For example, he thinks that any judgment of beauty has the appearance of being universal even though it isn't actually universal. If you see something you think is beautiful, you think everybody has to agree with you even though they don't necessarily. So for example, if you think that Lena the hyena here is, you know, the beautiful girl of the month, you want all of your friends to think like, oh, you assume all of your friends are going to think Lena the hyena is the beautiful girl of the month, and if they go like, what are you talking about? You're going to think they're barely even human. But the reason that beauty works that way is that it only works in society. The way that beauty works is it's what Kant calls a sensus communis, a common sense of things. So if, for example, you think that it's the most beautiful experience in the world to have a giant alien starfish put itself over your face, you're going to want all of your friends to experience the giant alien starfish over their face either, whether they're actually going to want to or not. It's going to appear to you that that's going to be the way that people like things to be. God, I love that picture. The other thing that Kant goes into is the idea of the sublime. He says the sublime is that in comparison with which all else is small. The sublime is something that's as big as Superman, 15 times as big as the Earth. It overwhelms you. It gives you a simultaneous sense of terror and delight. Terror in that there's this thing that's so much bigger than you that you have no idea what it could possibly be, and delight that you have the mental capacity to wrap your brain around the fact that there is something that's so big that you can't possibly make any sense of it. And so what you feel like is like the human torch here going like, we're like ants, just ants, ants, and that's kind of a cool feeling, and it's also kind of a scary feeling. So that's the sublime. Sublime gets thrown around for a lot of things in art and nature, but really it has to totally overwhelm you. Now, the other thing that Kant describes is what fine art is. Fine art, he says, is art that works through cognition, through thinking about it. Even though it pleases immediately, it goes to the brain instead of like, oh yeah, that's Wolverine with an ear, that's really kind of cool. But art, he says that fine art can't quite imitate nature itself. You can't have the idea that you're looking at a perfect imitation of nature itself, but the strange thing about art is that there's no rules for making it. Everything seems to be kind of strange about it. There's nothing that can always generate it. And one beautiful thing that art does is it can make even horrible or shocking things like beautiful or an interesting aesthetic experience. The one thing that it can't do that with is anything that's actually disgusting. So if it makes you lose your lunch, you can't aestheticize it. And what you need to produce something that's, you know, a beautiful or sublime experience is what he calls genius, which makes your head gigantic and also means that you can make things. There are no rules for genius. There's nothing that governs it. There's no rule that says what you can always do. So in conclusion, Kant says that beauty is immediate and it has giant adamantium claws that can rip through anything. That's my Twitter if you want to argue aesthetics with me. Thanks very much.